So let's jump into some of the details. So actually there are some legal restrictions impacting women in certain countries. So for example, if Mark and I were to go off to Saudi Arabia this afternoon, I would have to do something about the way that I'm dressed. I wouldn't be allowed to drive a car. There are also some cultural restrictions, so when we get there, Mark can shake hands, he can make prolonged eye contact, he can be sat alone in a room with a guy. These are all things that I would need to change as a woman just by travelling to a different destination. I need to think about my dress code, the way that I conduct myself, and the way that I engage with the locals potentially. And I'm from up north. Also, we are more prone to sexual assault, so statistically, women in general are more prone to sexual assault, whether that's physical, whether that's verbal. But it could be something as simple as catcalling. So, in fact, I had some guy chasing me around Berkeley Square not too long ago, but I was fairly okay with it. I'd done a self-defense course the day before, little did he know. But if that was to happen in another country, in another language, suddenly it starts to get a little bit more intimidating. But also sometimes we're less physically strong, and now I've passed my recent big birthday, it happens less and less. But I used to get to the stage where sometimes people would offer to give me a hand with my bag on the tube, and 99% of the time it was fine. But then there's that 1% where they think you're going to be together for life. And then also we carry our lives around in our handbags. And for those of you who work in five-star hotels, you'll know that this could be a problem. So we do some work with the Met Police, and we understand that there are gangs or organised crime rings who will target nice hotels, and the obvious place to do that is breakfast or is a check-in where you're leaving your handbag unattended. Now, when we do our female traveller safety training course, one of the exercises that we do, and I'm not going to get you to do today, is to get the women to calculate the value of their handbags. So we may be talking, you know, a few hundred pounds for a good handbag. We're talking about the purse, we're talking about all the stuff that's in there. And then suddenly you realise the value of your passport is priceless, that you've got the spending limit on your credit card, and then it's easy to understand why people might want to steal a handbag. But that in itself is traumatic. But when you've got your travel plans in there, when you've got your money, your mobile phone, your means of communication, your passport, suddenly that can get quite serious quite quickly and the risk can become compounded. And then also we've got some different health implications. So of course if you're sending women to a Zika area or somewhere where if they're pregnant, for example, they can't have the inoculations. But also if somebody is pregnant and they're in those first 3 months, maybe they haven't told you yet. So how do you deal with that? It's a bit of a minefield. If somebody has to travel, we've had lots of women telling us about the times that they've had morning sickness, but they've not been able to tell a male colleague, or they've been suffering with travel disruption and they've been held somewhere. Or what if a baby comes early? What about the travel insurance? Does it actually cover the repatriation of the baby and the mother? Or what about the medical facilities in country that you're sending people there? So there are just a number of reasons why we do look through a gender lens at female business travellers. And in fact, we've brought some reports with us today which cover a lot of research that we've done, so feel free to take them away with you. So looking back into that report, what we know is that, and we run this across lots of different segments, so we run this generally across all business travellers, all female business travellers, but we've also run it against academia and other various sectors, and the statistic is always the same. One in four women have suffered a negative incident when travelling on business, and 30% of those incidents were related to sexual harassment. 79% of women feel that they're underprepared to deal with an incident which might take place when they're travelling. But also 70% believe that the suppliers who are in the room today should try harder to cater for their specific needs. And I'll give you an example. We've got a new concert venue in Leeds. So it's the arena. So imagine that Elton John is playing at the arena. Somebody has a rate cap of £120 for a hotel. But suddenly Elton's arrived and the rates have gone up to £150, £160, £180. So what they're telling us is that they've been put out at hotels which are out of town. They don't know if there's any food available at the hotel, so that we've either had very hungry women or women who've had to venture out into an area that they don't know, where they've maybe had to get a cab. So actually the entire cost of the trip is more anyway, so they could have just put that person in a hotel which they normally put them in. They may have paid more on the nightly rate, but actually overall they would have been safer as well. So if we look at the duty of care cost and compliance triangle, so you've got cost, you've got compliance, you've got duty of care. If the travel manager just concerns themselves with duty of care, sorry, with cost and compliance, and forgets about duty of care, then it's all going to go a bit pear-shaped. Whereas if they concentrate on duty of care, it will drive compliance and therefore it will reduce the cost. And 31% of female business travellers don't feel that their employers adequately look after them. But actually, when we dug into that statistic, what we found is that of those 31%, about 50% didn't realise what their employers did for them. So they were doing a really good job, but they weren't communicating what they had in place. So I'm just going to give you an end-to-end journey of various women. These are real-life cases of things that have happened to women. And then you can maybe put that into some context about some of your own experiences and the experiences of your travellers. And then I'm going to give you some top tips on how to keep yourself safe. So this is Donna. Donna is actually an expert in travel security. And Donna was working for a large bank based on Canary Wharf, and it was their company policy that she would travel business class in business attire to her destination so that she could get off the flight at the other end and she could get straight into work. She flew into Islamabad. And she arrived in business dress, not dissimilar to where she was what she's wearing there on the video. But actually, when she got there, the driver and the people who met her were absolutely appalled that she was dressed in such a way. She was showing her legs, she was showing her arms. She was whisked back to the hotel and she was told to change into something which was more appropriate or more covered up. But also, her colleagues had said to her that she was staying in a westernised hotel, so obtaining alcohol wouldn't be an issue for her. She ordered room service because she didn't want to go out in the evening, and she ordered a glass of wine to come with her room service. Again, her male colleagues had no problem having alcohol in the hotel. She was told that it was really quite an issue, and she had to sign a medical form to say that she needed the alcohol for medicinal purposes. And she wasn't given a glass of wine, she was given a bottle of beer. We've got another lady, Rashida. She works for a university up north, and regularly she has to go to Stansted Airport. During that transit, she's not allowed to use a proper airport transfer company. She has to use a local minicab company. Now, Rashida is Asian, and she's in her 30s, and she's unmarried. So regularly, she's cross-examined by the drivers because they believe that she's bringing shame on her culture because she's in her 30s, and she's Asian, and she's unmarried. And she has to suffer this harassment, so slightly sexual, slightly racial harassment, all the way to Stansted Airport and back again. But when she reports this to her employers, they tell her that she has to use a minicab company because they're cheaper. Another lady was flying from the USA to Germany, mid-flight, fast asleep, she had a blanket over her. She walked to find the passenger next to her with his hand underneath the blanket, actually groping her. She reported this to the airline and she was moved into business class. But actually, after she'd gathered her thoughts, she wanted more. She wanted this guy to be arrested when he got off the plane. The airline refused to do anything about it. And she pushed and pushed and pushed. And in the end, the airline said, it's nothing to do with us. We didn't know who the passenger was. We've only got your word. So the US authorities didn't want to take responsibility and the German authorities didn't want to take responsibility for it. So now it's been investigated by the FBI. Another lady flying into Brazil, a chauffeur driver met her at the airport. He got her name on a nameplate, so of course that must be her driver. She got into the car. He wasn't her driver. He was someone who copied that nameplate and actually kidnapped her. She worked for a large media company. She was held for 2 weeks. It was a kidnap for ransom situation. And eventually she was released, but she never went back to work for that company. If you Google sexual assaults in hotels, not just in Johannesburg, not in Nairobi, not in Lagos, here in London, this does happen. So I'm not going to labour this too much. What I want to do is give you some tips and tricks on how you can prevent those kinds of things from happening. And many of you will know of many incidents that you've seen in the press where women who have reported a sexual assault in the UAE have actually been arrested for having unlawful sex. The only way that they can get out of that arrest is if the man who did it actually admits it and three male witnesses say that they saw it. So let's have a think about how you can protect yourselves and your travellers. First of all, research, research, research. So of course, whether you're male or female, these are some of the things that you need to think about when you're travelling on business. So looking at the country that you're travelling to, looking at the time of year that you're travelling to, looking at the stability of the government, but can you trust the judiciary system? And more important, what are the attitudes to women in the country that you're travelling to? Thinking about packing, and now we all know that we think that we've got there when we've got that designer suitcase. But what does that designer suitcase say about you? It says that you're female, it says that you may be wealthy, so it gives some idea of your level of affluence. So again, it makes you a target. So actually we recommend that our travellers travel in quite innocuous luggage, maybe a bright or a distinctive luggage tag. Again, nothing too girly or feminine, but just so that you can identify your luggage and you can get out of the airport as quickly as possible. Also adhering to local dress codes. Now that doesn't mean taking it to the extreme and looking like you've gone to a fancy dress party without being overt. Actually, some of our travellers tell us that when they get to a local airport, they will dress as casually as absolutely possible, so to look as least interesting. And maybe buy a local newspaper. Again, just pop that under their arm. They look like a local. They look like they know where they're going. Maybe carrying a backpack. So really of no interest to anybody who might be interested in robbing them. But also thinking about the valuables. Now, some of our clients are some of the richest diamond companies and jewellery companies in the world. So sometimes they have to wear product. But if you're travelling to somewhere like Latin America, we would strongly recommend that you leave your nice watch or your nice jewellery at home, and even think about taking whether you need to wear your engagement ring or wedding ring. But also, as you saw at the beginning there, Donna was wearing a cross and chain. So even something as innocuous as a cross and chain, which you might wear in this country, again could cause offence somewhere else. Thinking about the airport meet and greet. So we just talked about the example of the lady who was kidnapped in Latin America. So when you see somebody with a nameplate, that's not enough. We know that people can copy a nameplate. We know in some countries people work in teams, so they can photograph baggage tags and they can text them out to somebody outside and get a nice little nameplate waiting for you when you get there. But also we know that people steal other people's cars as well. So it's very easy for me to walk up to a driver who has a nameplate and say, oh, I'm Susan Smith, change of plans, we're going to the Hyatt now. And nobody's any wiser, but it means that the lady who is that person is left high and dry at the airport. So it's of the advantage of both the traveller and a hire car company or the chauffeur company to understand who's who. And the way that we would do that is to agree a password up front, or even have the registration number of the vehicle, or have a photograph of the driver. So have two or three different means of identifying your driver. But also thinking about having a backup plan if your driver doesn't turn up, what are you going to do and who are you going to call? And also thinking about if your flight's delayed and it was due to arrive in daylight hours, it may now be arriving at night, is your driver going to be there? So as I just touched on, obviously it makes sense to arrive in daylight hours, and I know in some instances, like if you're flying to India, your options to arrive in daylight hours are quite limited, but again that just allows you to be orientated. But also have an understanding of where your hotel might be. How do you know if you're being kidnapped? If it's an hour's drive, what are the key landmarks that you need to be passing? What do you need to be looking out for? And also, we've had a number of women who've been dumped on the side of the road, and I'm sure some guys too, because the drivers didn't know where to take them, because the addresses were written in English. So ladies in Russia, ladies in China, just ditched because the driver didn't know where to take them. And one of the big mistakes that I do, because I travel so often, is I forget where I'm staying occasionally. So if you take a business card from the hotel that you're staying, then you can show that to the taxi driver and hopefully they can get you back to where you need to go. And obviously pre-planning your first route is most crucial. We know that the biggest risk to any traveller, male or female, is ground transportation. So that's the quality of the vehicle, road traffic accident. But also we know that around 67% of women feel vulnerable when they're sitting in a car by themselves with the driver, because they're at the mercy of the driver. So if you can just take away the panic or the fear and de-risk that first bit of a journey, then you're hopefully on your way to a good, safe business trip. Thinking about hotel safety, so I just touched briefly on assaults in hotels. And I brought with me a gadget, which I sorry forgot to get out, but I'll show you afterwards if you want to see it, which is a door jammer. And it's something that I never travel without. So if I find myself in a hotel bedroom that doesn't have double locking doors, then I can always use this door jammer or a door wedge so that I can lock the door as well. Because we do know that quite often you'll find yourself in a hotel room and you clunk the second lock there, or you think it's the second lock, but actually it can be overridden with a master key. Obviously all the hotels that we recommend have got 24/7 manned reception, they're in a well-lit area, but also there are hotels which are handy for the train station, but actually if it's down the end of a dark street near a train station, it might be fine at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, but it might not be fine at 10 o'clock at night, but it's too close to get a cab. So just think about whether or not that actually is the right location for you, depending on what your plans are. Also, obviously, a lift key card access means that people are less likely to be able to get up to the floors where you're staying. And we also prefer hotels that don't put us in adjoining rooms, A, because they only carry one door jammer, and two, because sometimes the gap under the door is very high, so you can hear everything in the room next door, which I don't particularly like. But also we've had instances of women who've been in hotel bedrooms and they've had either somebody rattling on the door, or in one case somebody had a love note shoved under the door and she felt like you could see her. You probably just saw her going into her hotel bedroom. And also groups of hotels in the UK I can name who say that they've got a policy about not putting women on the ground floor rooms, or not putting them in adjoining rooms, or not announcing room numbers, but they still do. So what I would say is never, never, never tolerate this. If you have your room number announced out loud, it's not because you're a diva, it's because it's a safety risk. And so we had one incident where a lady checked into a hotel, they announced her room number and her name, and then there was a knock at her door and her name was used, and she let that person in and he subjected her to a serious sexual assault. Also thinking about safe leisure and meetings, so we've talked about handbag theft, so make sure that you keep your eye on your handbag or don't take it to breakfast if you don't need to. But you've also got all your badges on today. If you forget to take your badge off, it's very easy for someone to pretend that they know you. And I'm terrible with faces, I'm better with names, so I would absolutely fall for that one. And also thinking about drink spiking. Drink spiking doesn't just happen in nightclubs at 2 a.m. It can happen absolutely anywhere. It can also happen in a cup of tea, and there's also food spiking. So think about where you're leaving your food and drink. And then finally, moving on to social media. We all know it's really cool to be sat in a rooftop bar or in a lounge at an airport when you're about to fly off somewhere. But did you know that 75% of thieves have said that they've used social media to stake out properties that they were going to rob? And that's because they could see that people were actually away and they've checked in on social media. But also what it means is that your insurance will be invalidated. It will be void if it's found that you've been tweeting whilst you're on holiday or Facebooking where you are, and you're letting the world know that your property has been left unattended. And we also, Kim Kardashian in the newspaper recently, whose hotel room was compromised in Paris, but again, that had been all over social media. So these are just some top tips from me. Well, I've got a very short spot of 20 minutes, but I'll be here for the panel and I can share some more information afterwards. But here are some fantastic resources that you can use to investigate the countries that you're going to. The best source of advice really is from your colleagues, other colleagues, female colleagues who've been to the same place. Talk to them, talk to the regional officers, and just gather as much information as you can do. I know you're all thinking about your meetings and the work that you want to do when you get there, but actually if you get the travel administration out of the way before you get there, you're going to have a really successful business trip, and hopefully you can get a bit of leisure as well.
I think the absolute key thing about this is your duty of care, and it doesn't matter whether you're travelling personally or you're travelling for work. What does duty of care mean, and what is your responsibility to that? To not knowingly put somebody in harm's way. It's as simple as that. Now, if it's yourself and you're travelling for leisure, you have to take that responsibility. And that is why TUI actually did cover their duty of care. Because they put the responsibility back on the traveller. Because the travellers hadn't done their research. Now, the FCO had said that it was okay to travel. There were incidents, but it was okay to travel. That's how they got off. It wasn't their responsibility. It was the responsibility of the person that made the choice to go on holiday. So from a corporate perspective, it's a different thing. Who holds responsibility for the traveller? Well, the easy answer is everyone does. Everybody that makes that decision. Everybody that is involved in that decision. Whether it's a company themselves, the CEO, HR, obviously depending on the size of the company, some have HR, some don't. Those that don't have HR, a lot of travel is done based on trust. Oh, the boss says I've got to go, so I better go. That's not good enough. But you cannot underestimate that you as the traveller are responsible. Okay? There is one key piece of information that Carolyn touched on that you do not have before you leave for your trip. And that is your hotel room number. Now, you can be the best travel company in the world, the best travel planner in the world, the best, most responsible traveller. But it's a key piece of information because it's where you're going to spend most of your time and it's where somebody can come and find you if you've lost everything. Okay? So the research that Carolyn was talking about, you have to answer all of these questions before you travel. Why are you going? Do you need to go? Is the person going the best person to go? So we take the Saudi Arabia example. Now, this is where I'm going to be a little bit careful here. It will work better with a male or female member of staff. I'm going to come back to that in a minute. Key thing, is it safe? And if you don't think it is safe, question it. Now, Carolyn gave some very, very good places to look. For us, we use an array of governmental sites. Okay? To give you an example, they all have a very different policy. They all have very different political ideas or ideals. Thankfully, they all speak English. But to give you an example, if you just use the FCO, look up, when you get back to your desks, look up Saudi Arabia and what their travel advice is. But I guarantee you, and nowhere at all does it say anything about female travellers. Because it's political criticism. The US talk about it, Australia talk about it, Canada talk about it. Okay? If something goes wrong, the insurance company is only going to look at the FCO website. And if it says it is not safe to travel or only travel if absolutely necessary, you're not covered. And that needs to be monitored for the entirety of the trip. It's not just, oh, when we sent them out there, it was fine. Somebody needs to be monitoring it the entire time. Because if that changes, that person is no longer insured and neither are you from a corporate perspective. Okay? When I talk about this being open to challenge, there should be a channel within every business, and it doesn't matter how big or how small. Everybody should be challenging this. Even to the largest companies that have internal heads of security that do risk assessments on travel. If you as the individual do not feel comfortable, say so, because you need more information. And if you need more information, you can't just say, oh well, the head of security said it's fine, so it's fine. If you don't believe that to be the case, challenge it. But also, if you are the one booking the travel, you should be challenging it. Everybody through the entire process should be answering those initial four questions. Do you need to go? Why are you going? Is it safe? All right? It's really, really important. And if you don't currently have a system within your business that allows for this challenge to happen, particularly if you haven't got HR, because it can become an issue. Within this, and we've worked with an awful lot of women around the world who have been traveling for business and pleasure. There's an element of, am I being a princess? The answer is no, you're not. Challenge it. And if you don't feel safe, or you don't feel comfortable, or you don't feel the budget is high enough to get you what you require in terms of a hotel, challenge it and don't go. Or move the meeting to somewhere else. Okay? So I'm just going to give a couple of examples of women that we've worked with where they've got themselves in situations that made them feel horrendously uncomfortable. Thankfully, they all came back safe. But trip to Port Harcourt, it was a lady who worked for an oil company, and she'd just taken over from a guy who'd been in business for, been in within the business 15 years, he'd just retired. She'd come in, she was in charge of training around the world. Her first trip was to Port Harcourt, and she felt a little bit uncomfortable about that. It's not the nicest place in the world.
Where is it, Alexei?
Where Nigeria. Okay. Not the nicest place in the world. And actually, the FCA website was saying, don't travel unless absolutely necessary. Now, you could argue it was absolutely necessary because the people down there needed training. But at no point was she offered the opportunity to come and talk to somebody internally. And she put it on herself to actually end up calling us, even though it being a large oil company, they had their own security, internal security. But it was that question mark, I don't want to be a princess. I'm a woman that's walked into what has previously been a man's role. He would never have asked this question, so I'm not going to. She should have done. And she should have challenged it internally. She spent 2 weeks terrified. She never ever left her hotel other than to go and do the training and leave again. She came back and have completely reviewed how they work internally now. Okay. Now, somebody in this room will know about this Afghanistan trip, but we got a phone call from, say PA, probably EA. It was a trip for her boss who was going off to Afghanistan. Now, FCO probably not that keen on people going unless it's absolutely necessary. This didn't seem to us like it was that necessary, but her boss had said, please can you do the risk assessment? Now that's just unfair. You do not ask anybody to take that responsibility unless they actually know what they're talking about. And if you are going to do it, you get somebody that really does know what they're talking about and you pay for it. Because asking somebody that will just say, yes, boss, to do something which is a life issue is not fair. Okay? Cairo evacuation. During the Arab Spring, actually, the Canadian embassy was 70% female. They got stuck, along with clients of 35 other security companies. They got stuck in country because they had no exit strategy. They had no idea how to get out. And the biggest issue about the Canadian embassy was the number of women that were in the embassy. We had to evacuate. And we had to do it across land bridges. It couldn't be done via the airport. Okay. The reason we got the phone calls from the 35 other security companies, because none of them had thought what happens if they shut the airport. We'd been out there for 4 months beforehand building land bridges across the desert. Okay. Robust travel plan. Cannot stress this enough. This will save you from whatever happens. And that one piece of information that you didn't have, which was your hotel room, you need to tell the person that is going to hold this information. The travel planning, okay, is there to give you peace of mind. Can you stop every eventuality? No. Are we asking you to? No. But the handbag that goes missing, the handbag that gets stolen, what's in it? Did it need to be in there? And how quickly are you going to hand it over to the guy that wants it? It's as simple as that. And if you know you can do that, you're never going to end up in a situation where you're going to tussle. Same reason you don't wear a handbag across your chest. It was always the case. My mum always used to say, well, when you go to New York, all women wear their handbags across their chest. Don't. We saw a woman in Brazil get dragged 400 metres down a road because the guy in the car went past, grabbed it, and the strap didn't break. She broke both her legs under the rear tyres. Okay? Don't. If you've got something in your handbag that means you feel like you should wear it across your chest, it shouldn't be in there. It's as simple as that. So, this is a really simple thing that I will get Natalie and the team to send out to all of you. And please, please make it policy internally. It's really simple. It is all your key information. Now, there's a corporate element to this, so do you want to give up your bank card details to your work? Probably not. But there should be one person. Are you getting cold? It's getting a bit chilly in here, isn't it? Can we turn? Is that the thermostat there? My hands are starting to go as well. Just turning blue. Wear appropriate clothing. So, all of this, there is an element of corporate and personal, okay? But everything in here is to repatriate you with everything that you require to get out. So it's passport, it's really small, so I apologize, but it's full name, dates of birth, flights, when they're happening, what they are, passport numbers, accommodation. Remember to call whoever has this and tell them your room number. Bank cards, mobile phones with the SIM numbers, the IP addresses, etc., etc. Passwords, hospitals that are nearby. Please always find that out. So, alternate numbers. So if you've suddenly got a hotel room number, give it. It should be that person, whoever it is, and whether it's internally corporate or it's your next of kin that holds this information, one, you should have a copy with you. You should leave one in the safe at the hotel because that's the place you're going to get back to. Don't worry, your passport can be dealt with. And you need to make one phone call, and it's to the person that holds all of this information, and within 48 hours, you can have everything back, or new ones. Okay? This, in itself, will allow you to travel with an element of peace of mind. Because that handbag going doesn't matter. It's a bit of a pain. But hotels generally will be very, very good at supporting somebody in that situation. And if they're not, the person that's sent round from the consulate will be. plan, plan. And it doesn't matter if it is you're going on holiday. Please do it. Because your exit strategy comes out of this. Thank you.